5, 4. Wait, hold on. 2. I just got the giggles. Remember you did that? Because I made that face. Hold on. Okay.
5, 4, 3, 2.
I'm Riley Knox.
Hello, I'm Mr. Bouvier.
Hi, I'm Ernest Collins.
I'm Asia Dawson.
I'm Alvin King, and this is We Speak. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to another episode of We Speak. Tonight, we are here to talk about, the numerous current events that are going on around not only Washington, D.C., but let's just say around the world. So right now, one of the hottest topics on everyone's lips is this election with Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton. Trump was in Washington meeting with, Paul Ryan. Mm-hmm. And everyone seems to feel like that meeting went well, but I think that's more surface than what's really going on behind the scenes right now. What do you think about that?
I definitely think it's a lot more to it, and I'm very sure we're not going to know the real deal of what really went on during that meeting. They're going to play nice, but for Paul Ryan, Speaker of the House, to have such a strong opinion about Donald Trump and say, I'm not sure if I'm going to support him or not, that's very telling. And I remember I watched the episode of House of Cards where they had a secret meeting behind the scenes, and they were just as cold as ice to one another, but they came out smiling like everything was okay. And that's what this kind of reminded me of, that Donald Trump and Paul Ryan, he does not like him. I think he's an embarrassment to their party.
Well, that goes without saying. I can agree with that. But Donald Trump has also been, out of all the GOP nominees that have ever ran for office, he has got the most votes ever of any person running for that ticket. Now, that says a lot about America, if you ask me. I mean, with Donald Trump being the way he is and being as crass as he is, right. I mean, that says a lot about America right now, because he's saying some really crass things, and look how far he's gotten.
And it's interesting because I was talking to someone before. I have not seen anyone brandish a Donald Trump sign in their yard. I don't hear anyone going around talking about the fact that they're voting for him. You don't hear any of that stuff yet. An abundance of people are coming out and voting for this guy.
Yeah, where are these people?
Right.
In the Midwest? Are they in the Midwest?
They're in Hicktown.
I believe that they're in the Midwest.
I was talking to one of my friends, and I was telling them, my only Republican friend that I have. And I was like, well, how do you feel about this Donald Trump thing? And I asked him about the signs, and he's in Fairfax, and he says, oh, there are signs out here that say Trump, but I haven't seen one, and I don't know anyone who's actually seen a sign where people are supporting him. I was in Ashburn, and I saw this Humvee, and it had the Donald Trump picture on it, and Trump, that's the only thing that kind of made me feel eerie because I was in Ashburn.
Well, I don't think that all his supporters are in, like, these, in the sticks or West Virginia. I mean,
they're just undercover.
They're undercover.
In New York. I mean, that was unprecedented for New York.
They're not all there, but I think the most aggressive supporters are there.
Yeah, okay.
Right.
Like, you have people in major cities that are supporting him, but they're kind of supporting him on the low. You know, they're not ready to come right out and say, hey, I'm supporting Trump. They're doing it on the low. Right. You know, they're sliding some money to the campaign, and they're voting in there. Probably having their secret parties or secret meetings and fundraisers at their homes, because they're not ready to really come out at work and say, I voted for Donald Trump. They don't know how they're going to be received yet.
Well, do any of you think that some of the people who have been voting for him are people who don't normally vote?
Yes, I think that they're coming out the woodwork.
And that's kind of scary, because if they don't normally vote and now they're coming out and they're voting for him, you know, that says a lot about how this election could turn out.
But that's not much different than when Obama ran.
Yeah, I was gonna
people
say the same
came
thing.
Out and voted that never voted before.
Yeah,
and he won.
And he won.
And he won. But here's the difference. I look at Donald Trump like this. I compare him to, like, elementary. You know, when you're in elementary school, vote for me and I'm going to make sure we don't have any more recesses, or you're not going to have homework. When you're saying all these promises, but you can't really make these things come through. You know,
politicians
that's how I see him. And I think people who vote, a president is a high-paid spokesman. I think this nation is going to be in a lot of trouble if this guy actually gets in. And I mean, people here that don't like him.
Well, Donald Trump doesn't. I mean, okay, let me switch gears and let's talk about Hillary for a moment, because he's been bashing her personally. Mm-hmm. And my question to you all is, what approach do you think Hillary should take to run in the election against him? Should she come off fighting him the way and come at him the way he's coming at her?
Fight dirty with 30.
Or should she just
take the high road
mm-hmm. and deal with the issues that he cannot talk about,
which
he's dumbest.
Which is her strength. You know, I think she's
focused. You did say dumb.
He, okay.
He's a smart man, but he's dumb on the issues that really mean.
Correct.
We can discuss truth.
Yeah, okay.
But I think she should stay focused, and she should work with what she knows, and her strengths speak for her. You know, she don't have to stoop to his level, because she's not the type of person that he is. So it would just come off really crazy if she just thought, you know.
Genuine.
Well, they call it a smear campaigning, right? And for her, I don't think she has to do it. She has a team that can do that. I think the Republican Party's in enough trouble. They have enough material amongst themselves that they've actually said, verbalized themselves, that you can put together in a commercial or team. Mm-hmm. She doesn't say anything negative. I don't think she has to say a word. Stay focused on where she's trying to go if she gets the nomination.
I think that's the best way to go. I think that she need to stay the high road, as I stated before, and she has more of the educated vote.
Right.
She doesn't need to stoop to his level, and if she does, it's going to, like you said, come off very disingenuous, and it's going to look even more fake than people already say that she is anyway. Right. So stay in your lane. When you stay in your lane, you're more believable, you add credibility. Whatever that your lane is, stay in it.
Right.
Donald Trump, he's credible because he's a jerk. I'm going to keep it clean. He's a jerk. And so it comes off as that really is him.
Right.
And
right.
he doesn't have to be. He doesn't look fake. He doesn't look phony, because that's who he is.
Right.
When Marco Rubio decided to play dirty for a minute, it totally backfired on him.
Right.
You remember that?
Right.
And it did not sound like him. He looked ridiculous.
Ridiculous.
So be who you are. And if you note, too, a lot of the top Republicans are not supporting Donald Trump.
Oh, not at all.
And that's telling, too. And a lot of them are calling her and saying, hey, I'm going to vote for you. You have my vote. And so she needs to stay her course. Right. And I believe she's going to get it, because she has a more intelligent
approach
to it. Mm-hmm. And she has other Republicans backing her because of that.
Well, why are we talking about politics? And I'm going to switch gears just a little bit, but I want to give a shout out to Howard University. As we all know, you know, the graduates of 2016 had President Obama speak for them at their commencement ceremony. I heard the speech. I don't know if any of you have heard the entire speech, but there were a couple of points that he made to the graduates, and one of them was for them to be confident in their blackness.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And I thought that was so powerful, especially right now, when that class over the last 2 years have gone through a whole bunch of issues and things that have made them not necessarily question their blackness, but have to stand up for it.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And so I thought him telling them, okay, you're graduating now, you've just been through police brutality and all these killings. So I thought that was a very good point that he made to them. And I think another point that he made was that he told them to go beyond indignant rhetoric and uncompromising demands. Now, in some way, I thought he was telling them, don't go out here and be ignorant. You know, I felt like that's what he was telling them. And I had some people who were saying, well, you know, should he have said that to them? But I think
Why not?
Just because you're getting a piece of paper don't mean that you're ready to take on the world.
Absolutely.
But you should be.
Right.
That piece of paper. Anyway.
Absolutely.
So I thought that was you know, again, congratulations to Howard University class of 2016. And on the last political note, I want to talk about, you guys, if you like, the comedian called him a nigger, which made me think, so that word's now back in the, you know, has kind of surfaced. But the way he did it and said it, it was with, what's the word? It was, what am I looking for? It was sort of like a...
It was endearing. I get his point. I get it. He said, you made it my nigga, or something like that.
You made it my nigga.
However, I get his point. He's a comedian. He's trying to cause controversy and stir up some buzz. I get it. And he felt, hey, he's on his way out. Who cares? But you don't do that in mixed company, especially in the political environment and just the environment of the United States as it is now, period.
Right.
Donald Trump is behaving a certain way and in empowering ignorance.
Right.
He's empowering racists. Let's just be very honest.
He is.
He's empowering them. So when you say that, you have this racist energy in the country at this point. You have police brutality. You have young black men getting killed at the hands of police or being choked or police violence. And then you say that, it's just too many factors that you're like lighting a flame to fuel already. And I was uncomfortable with that because then you give people license for them to sit there and say, well,
if you
Larry Wilmore said it.
It wasn't the time.
He said it to the president.
Right.
And you don't say stuff in mixed company. You and I can have a discussion because we're at home talking.
Right. You saved that for the cookout.
Thank you. You don't
say that.
That
was a cookout conversation.
When we are in school, in class, or at work. Do you not know your environment? I just thought that was crass because you give people the entitlement that they can say it to, and then you're going to cause them to get beat up.
Let's
just
and then he kind of forced President Obama to
kind of... And I didn't like that.
You know, like, it put him in a hard position where it's like, do I call him on this or do I embrace it or do I,
right.
You know.
And that was, I didn't like that.
According to reports, they said that Obama took it very well and gave him, like, of course,
yeah,
you know, when
did.
Michelle Obama gave a fist pump, that became famous. But yeah. He gave him, like, the, what do you call the thing when you hit your chest? Like, you know, I'm all, I don't know.
I don't know.
He gave him the gesture like it was okay. But like you said, you think he was pressured to do
it. I agree.
It's like, what do you, it's like awkward.
It
like,
was.
Because had he just, you know, given him a look of disapproval.
Like, you did not just like, say that word, you know.
Yes.
Like, then people
yeah.
would, then it would, that would have been a story too.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Okay.
You know, Michelle said something they got home. I'm sorry.
You think so?
Yes. I know Michelle Obama said, are you kidding me? Do you know what you just got started, what this man got started? And you somewhat approving it by going like, do you know what you, I'm very
you
sure.
You think she gave it to him?
I'm very sure. Because she's his voice of reason. I strongly believe that.
But at
that.
The same time, he couldn't
like,
leave him hanging. You know,
he couldn't.
Obama is cool enough. He's like, you know, in his mind, I'm sure it was a quick reaction. I'm not going to leave him hanging. I'm going to go ahead and, you know, give him the little whatever. But
Michelle
in my mind, he's
it,
probably saying the N-word like,
well, while we're talking about mini train wrecks, can we talk about Metro?
Okay? Oh,
can
Lord.
We talk about
oh,
Metro right now? Now, I know Raleigh told me she doesn't like to ride Metro anywhere.
That's Shayna, too. No, that's Shayna. I was just thinking, as soon as you said that, I thought, well, Shayna's not here. So well, I've taken the Metro before.
You've taken Metro?
Shayna, on the other hand, is like, mm-mm. Yeah. Ernest, do you take it?
I certainly used to.
Okay.
Well, Paul, I want to give a special shout out to Paul Wiedefeld. He don't know who the heck I am right now, but for that man to have inherited this madness and making the changes that he's making and taking strides that he's taking and about to take to fix the problem, I'm giving him kudos. But it's just amazing to me that with all this going on, the people who are talking about it are people who they don't like change, first of all.
Right.
So my advice to them is, it's going to shut down or you're gonna die.
Right.
And if it shuts down, maybe you need a plan.
You know,
maybe, you know, upgrade your Uber account or get one, you know what I'm saying? Or figure out, call a friend, carpool, make changes because we need to correct this problem.
People are gonna complain regardless. You're gonna complain, I used to take Metro faithfully for years when I first moved here. So I can talk about Metro all day
long. I take it
long.
Every day.
I don't anymore because I have a different job. But it's like people are going to complain no matter what. I complained when I was sitting there for an hour before a train came during rush hour. I complained when they was pack us in like cattle, like sardines on the Green Line during the Nats games. And they didn't produce more trains during that time. They knew that. I complained then. I complained when they didn't have enough police. I complained about all of the smoke issues and the fires. I'm not going to complain because you want to make it better. Right. So it's like, sometimes it gets worse before it gets better.
Yeah.
So when people complain, it's like, but you know the end result's going to be a better situation. So accept the pain now, the temporary pain for the ultimate pleasure, or, you know, you're going to enjoy it. So just kind of grow up and get a plan B or C. You shouldn't have that in the first place.
But my issue, you said it's going to get worse before it gets better.
Yes.
It has gotten progressively worse.
Right.
I feel as though when they shut down for that day, they went in and just pulled out wires. Because
mm-hmm.
every week there's a fire in the tunnel. And it wasn't
right.
that bad, you know, at first. So I just feel like it's just, it's something going on behind the scenes that someone is trying to make happen. Because I just don't believe
make
that all of
bad
us...
bad stuff happen, or...
They're trying to force, I guess, Metro to close so they can fix it.
Mm-hmm.
But I just don't think that these fires are just naturally happen every week now.
More frequently.
And then it also bothers
that.
Me that they keep raising the prices. Like,
oh, no,
how do you keep raising the prices for a system that needs mm-hmm. so much work?
Yeah, I think raise the prices if you're going to improve the system.
Right.
But, you know, people, just like you said, people complaining about it getting, you know, about them shutting down to make it better. I don't think they should be complaining about that. I think people forget these are large pieces of machinery
yes.
underground, like
yes.
miles under the ground, like
constantly
you
running.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
and it's, you know, it's an older system, so it's bound to
right.
need some repair, and let them make the repair so that there's not more problems or accidents or
more
people
deaths.
Dying. Like, could you imagine like
mm-hmm.
a mass amount of people during rush hour just
right.
dying on the Metro? That would be crazy.
No, but when you think about repairs with Metro, you have to understand like. When I used to take the Metro, like, the escalator at Metro Center was broken for years.
Yeah.
I'm like, mm-hmm. how long is it to take? I don't fix, you know,
yeah.
I don't do anything yeah. like that. But you can't tell me that you're paying someone to keep working on this thing for years.
Yeah. Well, let's not forget, there was corruption and there was a lot of people stealing money. Let's not forget.
But that's
so,
been going on for a while.
Right.
I'm big on safety. Being in transportation for all these years, safety is like the number one priority. So there, from an airplane to a train mm-hmm. to a bus, if it means shutting it down to save lives, make it happen.
Mm-hmm.
Because when we take this public transportation, we're trusting and believing that everything
right.
is working straight.
Right.
That the guy that's supposed to run this train has done his safety works, that the people that have got paid to do the track work when we're single tracking, that they're doing their job. And clearly people have been cutting short and not doing the jobs from managers. I
right.
commend them as well. Mm-hmm. I fire everybody from the head down. If there's
right.
something that you
Absolutely.
Signed off on
mm-hmm.
that didn't happen, kill everybody from the beginning on down. Fire them all. Not kill, excuse me.
Kill the career.
And right.
And go ahead and nip it in the right. bud and get it right.
And
but how are we
going to
pay these people that don't have a job because Metro is shut down?
Well, hold that thought. We're going to take a commercial break. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be right back.
This is gonna be delicious, I can tell you that much. And there you go.
Excuse me, where's my plate?
You don't get a plate.
Why not?
It doesn't matter.
My plate matters.
Hey, all plates matter.
Oh, yeah, of course they do. I'm just saying, where's my plate?
Are you saying your plate matters more than mine?
Yeah, my plate matters too.
Okay, but you all have your plates and I don't have mine. So what's the problem with what I'm saying? And you know what? I didn't get the right drink either. I asked for a cup of just ice. You gave me just air.
Who the hell orders just ice?
I like the way it tastes when it melts.
So you want water?
No, I want a cup of just ice.
What do you want?
You don't get justice. I mean just ice.
Well, if I don't get just ice, you don't get a tip. No just ice, no tip. No just eyes, no tip. No just
eyes,
no tip.
Hey, you don't get to deny the waiter his tip. You don't know what he has to go through with these customers.
He won't give me my plate.
Man, you don't understand the poor man's situation and his side of the story.
Everyone saw him deny me my plate in just ice.
I didn't say that.
I didn't say that either, man.
Wow.
Well, I mean, you have a history of not tipping, so maybe you didn't deserve the just ice.
Really, you gonna go there?
Okay, you know what? Let's just ask the waiter why he didn't bring the plate and a cup of just ice.
Well, he was looking at the menu for a suspiciously long time.
I was ordering food.
And he tried to reach for one of the straws on my belt.
I needed a straw. Give me a straw.
Jesus, Thomas. Look, what's wrong with you, man?
It's enough of that.
All right, just chill.
Can I get you guys anything else?
No just ice, no tip.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Before the commercial break, we were talking about Metro and all the issues and concerns that are going on with the system. And before we went into break, DeMond was about to share some comments with us.
Yes, I was concerned about, you know, with the talks of a shutdown, how are the people that are operating the trains, how are they going to get paid for all this time that the system is shut down?
Well, some of the operators are at fault too. So
they still need to get paid.
They get paid. That's what they call vacation. Well, there's leader. They can get paid.
That's not fair. That's not fair for a system that's not their responsibility per se to be shut down and they're out of work and they have to use their vacation time that they're earned. That is not
so
fair.
So we know that they're not getting paid when the system's shut down?
No, that's what I'm saying. You know, is there no one has spoken of that?
Oh.
You know,
they're part of a union, aren't they?
Right. Not only that, I mean, train operators, all these guys are. They can drive buses. They can use other equipment. There are other, because I mean, if the system shuts down underground, mm-hmm. we're gonna all go above ground. These guys can drive a bus.
Do you know that they have a license to drive a bus?
Absolutely. You can't drive the train unless you drive a bus.
So they can still get paid.
Do you happen to know someone who works for Metro?
I
work.
Don't.
Okay, you don't. Okay, I'm just saying.
I just know that they.
I mean,
they
I want to make sure that you don't step on no toes. Because, you know.
Well, that's just what the streets of D.C. need.
Someone that lives with me.
Right. You want to pay your.
Are you going to pay your mortgage? Rent is coming from. No, I just know that they make a lot of money and overtime and things like that. Mm-hmm. So, it's not just as. It's a lot of factors to just shutting down the Metro system.
Right. Well, part of that, though, can go towards training. I mean, they have training dollars that they can send them training to. I mean, so as a manager, that's how mm-hmm. I'm saying all this. When things can't be done, as your normal work day can't be done, there's dollars that are allotted for trainings. Mm-hmm. And trainings can expand many different areas. Right. So they can be paid and be sent to trainings. They can be paid to do administrative work. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of things that they can do. To get paid and to be productive.
I'm gonna be nice. I'm gonna be nice.
But
some of the conductors that I hear on the microphone, I don't think they can do. I don't think that they will excel in administrative work.
But they can be taught. And if they lose their job, they can at least go to a presentation class.
Like all of this training and everything sounds nice, but at the end of the day, most of our Metro operators are Black. For a system that is out of control as it is now, I don't think that they have a plan in place to assist these people to get them to a different level, a different area of the Metro system. I just can't see that being the case.
Well,
and I feel like
a lot of them
will be lost, and a lot of them, it would affect their livelihood.
I don't agree with that.
Well, he just
only
met with 650 of them last week. So I'm sure that there's a plan in place. What do you call it? Not a survival.
Contingency plan.
Contingency plan to do that. You can't just like shut it down and like not have a plan. So I think there is a plan to take care of people who are not directly involved.
I agree.
With it, with the problems, but that fails to be seen. So
we'll see.
But we shall see. But in the meantime, we're gonna move on down the road to North Carolina right now because they have some issues down there. Okay. And speaking of the government is involved. The government, the federal government is suing the state of North Carolina for this bill that they have preventing transgender people from using the restrooms that speak to who they are as a person. And North Carolina is now suing the federal government.
Wow.
They can do that?
Well, the federal government was suing North Carolina.
They are.
They're suing each other. Mm. Well, because
I know you could. You can.
I want to see them win. I want to see North Carolina win.
You do?
You want to see.
It's not going to happen.
Oh, you mean?
I was like, really?
I was like, really?
Hold on.
What?
Listen, you were here. Hold on.
To show you how big this, or how important this issue is. I mean, major stars are pulling out of North Carolina.
They're not doing concerts there.
Companies like PayPal are taking their business out. They were going to open companies in North Carolina, and North Carolina doesn't seem to care. And because now these bigots are on platforms, really, to me, that's all they are, because they're racist, and this is discriminating, and I just think it's another opportunity for them to get on their platform to talk about something that just doesn't make sense.
You said they don't seem to care, but have you ever seen someone who's just so strong in their conviction that they just really don't care what like it's at the detriment of other people. Well, we're still going to stand up for what we believe in. That's all throughout slavery. Yeah, we know, you know, it's causing our economy to go down. It's causing people to, you know, pull out of things and the business and all this stuff here. But we're still going to stand by our conviction, like people that are just loud and wrong.
Yeah, yeah.
Right.
But when the dollars start coming in, I think that people will think.
That usually, that's usually a defining moment in whether or not this is really going well.
Right.
But in this case, I don't think so, because they're comparing it to, they're talking about comparing the situation to pedophiles raping kids.
That's ridiculous.
And that's ridiculous.
That's what? Ridiculous.
What is their ground for suing, North Carolina's ground for suing, it's just countersuing?
It's sort of countersuing, they're countersuing them, saying that the federal government is in some way interfering with them. Mm-hmm. Freedom of speech, or them developing their constitutional rights to make a choice in their state.
Right.
So
they feel like they're overstepping their boundaries.
Their boundaries.
And it's saying that the federal government passed this edict down saying, you know, transgender bathrooms or family bathrooms or whatever. And North Carolina is saying, no, you can't impose this upon us because of our religious rights and freedom and whatever. Mm-hmm. What we stand upon. So we're suing you back because you're infringing upon our Second Amendment rights.
Second Amendment rights?
Freedom of religion? I sound very ignorant right now.
I don't know them by heart. I think most people only know the fifth.
They're constitutional rights.
Thank you. They're,
mm-hmm. Yes.
Thank you.
So, you know, my question to the panel is, you know, what's your thoughts on, you know, I guess not. Well, I'm going to say making this better, making this go away. How do you see this playing out? Because it doesn't seem like it's going away. At first, I thought it was going to be something that, you know, they put out there, and you know, it may go to the federal level. Mm-hmm. But it's going beyond that, and I think that the fight, there's a possibility that the federal government may lose. Now, North Carolina is going to lose a lot of money because people are not going to go. Mm-hmm. But as you said, when people are so strong in their convictions, they don't give a flying monkey about it. You know, so
who they're hurting.
Right.
Right.
So they're going to do it. So
I just wonder how the people that live in North Carolina that disagree with them, how do they feel about the fact that they're missing out on things.
Right. Happening. They're suffering.
Oh, yeah, honestly. We're suffering. Everybody. It's like. Everybody's going to suffer.
They're going to Richmond.
You know.
Virginia's going to get influx.
They're going to Richmond. That seemed kind of valid. I mean, in hearing a lot of the reasons why, but the one thing I heard is the concern is people getting dressed. I guess people getting dressed and going into the opposite bathroom and possibly molesting or taking advantage of a situation. I mean, it has to be tweaked. I'll give it to them. But, I mean, say, for example, if I'm a pedophile, if I'm whatever, and I put a wig on and a dress, and I
yeah, they're gonna do that anyway. People can do that anyway.
I agree.
They don't need a law.
That's what they're saying, but I mean, it's a reason to be concerned.
Well, a pedophile is gonna be a pedophile.
Right.
Right.
And so a pedophile doesn't. I mean, I've never been a pedophile,
thank you.
And will never be one. But I think that pedophiles don't wake up in the morning thinking, okay,
right,
let me put on stockings and go into,
just like them,
you know, or put on a wig or a dress or whatever.
Right.
A pedophile is going to be a pedophile. That urge hits, in my opinion, they're going to do whatever they're
exactly
going to do.
Right.
So
it's just like when people say, you're dressing your daughter in a way. Don't you know there's pedophiles out there? Well, you know, they're going to look at them either way because they're pedophiles, not just
right,
because
they're
the kid
sick
is
anyway.
Dressed
right.
In, you know, a little short skirt or a little, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Same thing with rapists.
Right, rapists.
It's not because a woman had on a short skirt or because she, you know, they're going to be rapists whether she had on that skirt or not.
I agree.
Well, I think we're ready for a little bit of pop culture right now. I think we're going to cool it off again. And right now on the scene, in terms of cooling it off, Justin Timberlake and J-Lo have just released their new single. And I don't know if any of you have heard it, it was just released. And critics are saying these two have the songs of the summer. I think it's too early to tell. First of all, we're in D.C. We haven't seen summer. We haven't seen summer, so we don't even know where summer is or if it's coming.
We haven't seen the sun.
Well, we haven't seen the sun.
Exactly.
Because his sister's Prince died 15 days ago. So
purple rain.
And your purple looks nice.
Thank you. So we haven't seen it, but I don't think, you know, that's I've heard Justin Timberlake's new song. Mm-hmm. I actually like it. I've heard J Lo's song, you know, You Ain't My Mama.
I ain't your mama.
I don't know if I don't know if they're gonna be the songs of the summer. But right now, if you all get a chance to listen to it, I think you'll agree with me. Justin Timberlake is on to. Mm-hmm. He's on.
I haven't heard either of the songs.
I heard both of them.
And
I
you
even
do
performed
like them?
One of them.
Oh,
clearly,
okay.
Not the Justin.
I saw that and it was amazing.
Thank you.
But I'm more baffled that we go to pop culture. You go with Justin Timberlake.
I'm wondering the same thing. That's not pop culture part.
The thing is,
I heard his song. I mean, I thought it was cute. It was not his normal stuff. I thought it was.
Oh, okay. And I like his.
It's
music,
a part
typically.
Of. It's going to be in a movie. It's a part of the soundtrack for some car. One of those kids movies.
One of the kids movies.
One of the kids movies. Yeah, but it wasn't like Happy by Pharrell. It wasn't like that to me. Well, it didn't move me like that. And it, you know, that was part of the little Minion
Happy Feet.
Movie. Yeah.
Well, that's I was surprised. and you say that when we talk about pop culture, we talk about Justin Timberlake.
But see, I'm about to have a Kanye moment right now. Because Beyonce just released the best album of the year.
Really?
And
oh,
of her
no.
career.
I don't think so. Lemonade?
Justin Timberlake and Jennifer Lopez on the table.
I don't think Drake has views from the 60s. And you thought I'm like talking about that.
We
should be talking about Drake and Beyonce instead
I agree.
Of
well, because the critics Justin are Timberlake not saying and... that Formation, which I love dearly, they have not said Formation is going to be the song of the summer.
Now, it's been out a while.
Entertainment industry, as an artist, I feel as though songs are not the end thing anymore. It's about albums. Mm. Beyonce has just upped the ante and is about albums. She sent her whole album to the radio station. Play what you will.
Pick what you like and play it.
I don't care what the single is. I don't care what the song of the summer is. This is my album.
Because
this is
people
my collection.
No longer, as an artist, also, people don't listen to a body of work anymore. They just, you know, it's just the hot singles that
right,
are, you know,
true.
Out.
Right.
And no one listens to actual people don't even make albums anymore. Right. They make EPs right. or they make little, right. or they just throw out right. singles here right. and there. Mm-hmm. And you're thinking, well, when's the album come? When's the album? There's no album, you know, whatever. So, I think there's something to be said for people who trust their body of work, whereas right. there are no B-list, you know, there's no B-tracks. It's all good, and mm-hmm. it's a body of work that's collectively together, you know, that they can present to the world as a piece of art. I think that's there's something that should be said for that, and it's not because I'm a Beyonce impersonator or...
I did not like Lemonade. I'm sorry. I will say, I'm not a fan of Lemonade. I think
before you
that,
start preaching.
I know, I'm gonna... Don't get the pitchforks after me, but I'm not a fan of that.
No joke, I know.
Be careful. And you know what? Direct your emails to asia@msn.com. No,
and I was reading the reviews about her show, and they were kind of lukewarm mm-hmm. on Lemonade, but her older, you know, her previous material. Now, let me switch gears.
Where are we going?
I think, I think Lemonade is brilliant. I'm a Bay fan, okay? Mm-hmm. I think it's brilliant. However, like Asia, Lemonade hasn't grown on me the way her other projects have grown on
listen
me.
Listen to it a few more times.
But I got to listen to it a few more times.
But the thing about it is.
How the media is now. The media will play it over and over, and you will eventually like start bobbing your head to a snap of your fingers, and you will join that number one crew.
Well, on June 10th, I have a 10th row seat.
But see, this
on the floor,
is. Okay, so now. And I knew you were going to say that. So here we go, Devon.
I'm ready. I'm ready.
Here we go. All right. Here we go.
Okay.
You first.
I'll go first.
They got those fingers out, okay?
Because I'm going to tell you. This is I'm a Beyonce fan, obviously. Beyonce impersonator. Mm-hmm. However, for me, this is the Beyonce that I've been waiting on. Okay. This is the one, there's so much depth to this. Mm-hmm. There are issues that she's tackling, and it's not just a bunch of like ass shaking and, you know, a whole bunch of like stuff that's just gonna make you, it's making you think, it's provoking mm-hmm. people to think.
It's
and
a message.
It's a message, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And it's a collective body of work. Like it's each, the songs go together. It's mm-hmm. not just like, oh, she decided to throw in a, like, you know, a track just so people can, you know, shake their asses. But we've had that, you know what I mean? Right. We've had those songs for years from Destiny's Child of those ass shaking songs. But now it's sort of like, as her fans, it's sort of like, and even as the public, it's like, I'm growing, grow with me.
Right, right.
Here's where I want to take you, just the journey I want to take you on.
Mary J. Blige had the same exact issue. Now, I want to say so much. I don't like Lemonade. I think that Beyonce is an entertainer. She's a performer. I look to her sometimes as, get me away from my problems and my issues. Let me shake my behind. Let me just shake a tail feather and just escape my reality listening to B-Day album.
So that was a party song.
So you don't want to hear problems.
I got my own.
But see, that's the great thing about the concert, is you're hearing everything. But go ahead.
But what I was going to say was, Mary J. Blige had the same exact issue. Remember that? Mm-hmm. She was so, my man left me and men are horrible. Remember that? And I love that Mary J. Blige.
Yeah, okay. I love they liked her miserable.
That Mary J. Blige. What's the 411? Well, anyway, I'm a big Puffy fan anyway. Okay. Yeah. But all those CDs that Puff Daddy and he produced for her, all that. I loved it. But then when she tried to switch gears, when she was happy and she had her happier songs, people revolted against her. Do you remember that? I remember that.
I remember that. I remember people saying we like her better miserable. Like, and I thought this is terrible.
Well, no, that's nasty. Yeah. That's mean. It's not like someone miserable. Right. It's like she's a balladeer and she's saying from her stolen from her depths. Mm-hmm. She was not the party entertainer. That is not what she was known for. And even still now, I'm not going to look to Mary J. Blige's song to party off of. I'm not.
Well, she do.
Family Affair is pretty good. Party.
I didn't like that song.
It is we have to allow people to grow because if you're an artist, this is your art. And your art is not going to stay the same. It's always going to represent your life if you are a true artist.
Right.
If you're just somebody who's just doing something for the moment, we can get with whatever you put out. But if you're a true artist, your art is always going to be reflective of your life and what's going on in your life.
Yeah.
I feel like this album, Lemonade by Beyonce, it's just so important for people because you can learn a lot from this album. She's giving you who she is. You know, people always say, who is Beyonce? We don't know who she is. And she's da da da. But she's laying it out there. I'm real.
It's Lemonade's just like with the last album where everybody was like, well, we're so used to Beyonce being nice and, you know, and really sweet and not cursing and not talking like overtly sexual and, you know, not doing that. And now she's got her clothes off and she's like naked and talking about, you know, having sex with her husband
like
in the back of a car and all this stuff.
I like that CD,
But people have the same argument that you have. Mm-hmm. They have the argument. They're like, well, we're used to her being this way. And the thing about being an artist is you can't put us in a box.
Right.
You can't just say, oh, well, this is
just who we are. Because then we won't want to do it anymore. If you won't let me grow, then I don't want to do it.
A lot of artists have said that. A lot of artists said, don't put me in a box. I want to grow. I get that. But I'm not feeling Lemonade. I like the Drunken Love CD. The one, I don't even know what it's called.
Beyonce.
That was just Beyonce. Yeah. I like that CD in all actuality. I like some songs on there I liked. I don't like Lemonade. In all honesty, Beyonce has always been so careful with her image. Do you really sit there and think that she really bared her soul?
Absolutely.
I do.
With Lemonade. I don't think so. I don't. I don't think that she... I think that it's calculated.
I've heard her even say that I talk to people through my artistry. You've noticed she doesn't do interviews.
You don't see her doing interviews anymore.
You don't see her talking about anything. She doesn't answer. And when there's scandal, she doesn't go and do a press release.
She's not on Twitter clapping back.
She doesn't even have cap notes on her pictures on Instagram. Mm-hmm. She talks to people through her art, through the pictures on Instagram. She just lets them speak for themselves. If she wants to address an issue, she wants to talk about something, just like the elevator thing. She talked about the in a song.
In a song.
Yeah.
I remember that, yeah.
And people knew something was wrong because that's why the album came out. You know, you want to know what happened in the elevator? Well, here's the whole album, so you don't have to ask that question anymore.
Right, it was $1 billion
All right,
in the
D-Hive, I get it. Y'all like Lemonade.
As much of a queen as we all know that she is, okay, we're going to be talking about her throughout the rest of this year. I guarantee you, without a doubt, good, bad, or otherwise.
And that's all part of the plan.
She is not the only, star who's doing, great things. I don't know if you've heard, but Rihanna now has a scholarship. Her new CD that she has, that she's put out, which is getting a lot of hits. Actually, the critics are praising her right now. Her new CD is giving $50,000 to deserving students right now. And she's really playing it up. Her new CD is about to drop. I think it's next week. And again, she's
Her CD's been out.
Is it been out?
A long time.
I'm sorry. Her program.
What are you talking about?
Her program.
Justin
thank
Timberlake.
You. I'm sorry. We have a lot of pop. We have a pop queen right here. I'm Grisha a lot.
Justin Timberlake.
But her scholarship program is doing quite well, and so yes, we all love Beyonce, but I just want to make a point that there are other people who are out there doing some wonderful things
with
their
Rihanna.
Art and their career. Good. And we're going to take a break, ladies and gentlemen, so we can cool off from the
I need a break.
Right.
We'll be like
I get hot here.
These men will most likely not be president, but they showed us that we have common interests, we have common grievances, and in numbers we are powerful. We threaten the establishment of both parties with righteous indignation, and if we don't continue the conversation, the media will end it for us. Obama should have been a great awakening for the American people. It's not enough to participate in heavily choreographed elections every 4 years. The parties that you're in many cases required to join to even participate in democracy don't have your best interests in mind anymore. And we know that now for a fact, Republicans and Democrats. The financial institutions we bailed out are bigger than they were before they crashed the world's economy. Our foreign policy and our trade deals make us less safe. They restrict our civil rights, wreck our environment, and repress the people of other countries while making a handful of oligarchs rich. It is class warfare, and first class is winning. But we're connected now. The secrets are slipping, consciousness is rising, and business as usual is over. If you stand for justice and truth, don't just do it from behind a computer screen. Get out into the streets when necessary. Vote out your representatives, run for fucking Congress. When Bernie Sanders says we need a political revolution, we take it with a grain of salt because it's being broadcast on CNN, but that's it. That's what we need to solve our problems, not a president. And we know that, right? But we continue to voice our complicity through our inaction. If you're angry, you should be. And if you want change, you gotta fight for it. But let's fight together. Our lives depend on it. And don't give way to cynicism, because this is just the beginning. And don't expect salvation from those who seek to divide us, because we can only find it within each other. We're connected. We're awake now.
And this is We Speak. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. As you can see, before we took a commercial break, we were totally caught up in the beehive of things. We have since cooled down, and we passed around a glass of lemonade, of which Asia decided she was not going to drink. She passed on it. Talking about a little bit more about pop culture, we're going to move on to the Kardashians, because a report came out today, Riley. One of the Kardashians' book authors says that Caitlyn Jenner is thinking about detransitioning back to male.
Who said that?
One of the Kardashian book authors.
So like one of those unauthorized autobiographies.
That's what it sounds like.
They didn't say that on this news feed, but.
I don't believe that.
Okay,
I'm sorry,
y'all
I'm
really
want to
go there with me.
So well,
I don't believe it's true. This is like something you read in The Onion.
Well,
right. Get the hell out right. of here.
I don't believe that to be true.
Well, especially since she's getting ready to pose nude for Sports Illustrated.
Right.
But go ahead.
I don't have to tell you.
Go ahead. I
don't believe that it's true, but I would not be surprised.
Really?
I'm not surprised at anything that has anything to do with a Kardashian.
She's not a Kardashian.
Yeah.
he's been around them long enough. She has been around them long enough. She's an honorary Kardashian. And you this know, whole new thing.
I do think she's a fame whore. But
I'm just not here for
her. I don't.
Well,
I don't.
Fame whore. I'm
like everyone
thought. I'm not
that.
Running to buy Sports Illustrated to see
me
Caitlyn Jenner.
No, me either.
On the cover, in the book. I'm
I don't think that's necessary to post the news. Like,
fame
for any 60-year-old woman. Like,
tendencies.
Did he get the surgery?
Yeah, I'm like, is the surgery complete? What's going to happen?
I don't think so.
I think, like, similar. On the cover, you can't be on the cover of Sports Illustrated butt naked.
First of all, let's be clear on that.
So it doesn't matter.
A bikini, probably.
Yeah, I mean, like, maybe, like, tastefully covered up or something. I don't know. But, I mean, you can't just be Spread Eagle on the cover of...
No, you can't.
Source Illustrated is not the magazine.
Period.
Why does it matter?
Well,
I don't think it's true because
Caitlyn
waited too long to do this. And I don't think that Caitlyn's going to go back and say, I'm going to revert. No, I think it's silly. I think it's just more of getting my name in the spotlight and being around the
First
Kardashians.
First of all, did she say that?
No,
well,
right.
I saw the news feed today that this author came out with.
Did
it.
She say that?
It didn't say that Caitlyn Jenner said it.
Okay.
It did not say that Caitlyn Jenner said it.
I wouldn't be surprised.
It did not.
You know what? It's funny that you said the card.
Because
I am Kardashian.
I am canceled.
Yeah.
So now
you. That's my pity.
You want to detransition?
Right.
I want to be Bruce. New show.
That's my point. And I think that anything Kardashian is fame whore tendencies.
Right.
Excuse me, Riley. Sorry, but I think it's like an adjective now.
Mm-hmm.
Kardashian yourself. I mean, Kardashian is not a term of endearment. When you're referring to someone being a Kardashian, you don't hear anything good about them. Mm-hmm. It's all negative. Right. It's all simulated.
Whether it's true or not.
Whether it's true or not. I'm not a Kardashian fan. I think that they look at Riley looking at me.
I'm biting my tongue on both subjects.
Since we're talking about highs and lows, I'm going to go low. I'm
going
to go low on this one.
Where
are
we going now? Love and hip-hop?
No, we're not going to go love and hip-hop. No, we're going to go to the story that actually came out today about George Zimmerman. Mm-hmm. And George Zimmerman went on an auction line to auction the gun that he used to kill Trayvon Martin. And the auction line discovered, I guess, I don't know how they did it, but they discovered who he was, and they took it down. But the nerve.
And then another auction house picked it up.
Are you kidding me?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
Yes. I mean, as I was getting dressed to come here, I was watching TMZ, and they contacted the auction house, and that put it down. The people who put it up did not have a problem with it, but the auction house did. And then another one did pick it up, and they said they have no problem with it. Hmm. So you've got to be kidding me, by the way, that we are in 2016 and we're having this conversation.
That's my point.
Right.
That's my point.
Right.
Like, sometimes I just sit back at some of the conversations that we have to have, and I think, like, really?
It sure, you know, it confirms that desperate people will do desperate things, and then there are people who will, you know, adhere to it. I mean, if I was the auctioning company that bought the gun, I would be scared that somebody would come to burn up my shop or, you know.
This
or
is the climate, you know, of the United States of America, mm-hmm, that I spoke about earlier. This is the climate.
Right.
You have people that think that that's like a souvenir or something like a deer head or a animal head upon your wall as a trophy. And it's disgusting. That's what I'm saying. Donald Trump is real.
But don't you feel like a few years ago, there weren't people that were that bold?
I agree.
And now it's like we're reverting back. Like, people are feeling bold enough.
Thank you.
Like, they may have always thought that way before, but now they've got license to.
What's the catalyst?
Donald Trump.
And once you go forward, very rarely do you go back in. Once you let it out, it doesn't come back in.
It's true.
We have to be very careful on what we let out of the box.
Yes. Because once it's open, you can't spoil it. I like my racist out in the.
So I
like
to know who
you are.
Yeah, I don't want you to laugh in my face and come to my show and, you know, love my performance and then be a closet racist. No.
Good point. But I don't want you to feel empowered.
Throw pearls on the floor.
I
want
to throw pearls
when you come out there before.
I don't want them to feel empowered. And I don't want them to think that it's okay. I want to know who you are.
I like to know. I like them out. Yeah.
I want them to feel. I want them to feel more fearful. I want them to keep their stuff in check.
Yeah.
Because if you feel they feel that they can't have to keep it in check because they're allowed to do this, it's permitted,
right,
that's when it gets really dangerous. Right. When you feel it's okay, you want to buy a gun that is infamous now.
And they're saying it's going to go at least for like $150,000.
That's what I'm saying.
Probably go for more than that.
Yeah. That's they're saying at least.
Well, it's like a trophy.
Like you said, there's a lot of hatred going
on. When he originally put it on there, it was for $5,000.
But see, so okay, have you no heart at all? Even if you thought that what you did was right, which it was wrong, but have you no heart for this person's family? Like, could you imagine, like, as a parent, like, the gun that killed your son
is in somebody else's hands.
Right. And where in his head, he's got to be a lunatic.
Right.
Because where in his head does he not think, like, what are people going to think? Like, you know what I mean? Like, who are there? I would think if that were me, like, no one's going to support this. If I put this up, nobody's going to buy it. Like, this, no one's going to support this. There are not people out there that are as crazy as I am. Well, but there are.
There are. Because there have been people supporting him the entire time.
His name constantly. If you guys notice, he's constantly doing things to keep his name active in it.
Right, he's been to the gun show.
But you would think you'd want to hide so that you don't get assassinated.
But everybody's covering him. Like, that's crazy. Somebody jumps into his defense, steps in front of the bullet, and takes up for this guy. So everything he does, he feels like he's invincible.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we have reached that point of the show where we have to close. And unfortunately, we're closing on a pretty down note about George Zimmerman. So let's raise it and say that mental illness is real, okay? Mm-hmm. And something has to be a little off about George Zimmerman. So we're going to pray for him. Thank you all for joining each other tonight. And until we see each other again, take care of yourselves. Good night, everybody. Until next we speak. Have a good night.
And cut.
Wait, you were happy with that closing?
Oh, no. Shut up!
I'm just saying somebody's going up.
Shut up! I didn't have a damn. Shut up!
Going
shut up, okay? But you know, I'm gonna write it down the next time, Tony, I swear.